trying to do now is to trace the relationship between humans and the environment in the past. I'm doing it under communism, under the Cold War, but there are environmental historians who work on very different historical periods, from the ancient Egyptians and Romans through the Middle Ages until recent times. The birth of environmental history is closely connected to the rise of environmentalism in the West, and especially one book, Rachel Carson's Silent Spring. It was published in 1962, and it was a very important book in the United States. And I think most people don't know, but it was very important also in Eastern Europe, in the Soviet bloc. The communists wrote a lot about it, and they praised it, especially in the 70s. When I was a kid in the 1980s, in Hungary, environmentalism was very important on the level of propaganda and education. The country was falling into pieces, and the economy was suffering, and the factories were producing a lot of pollution. But I was in elementary school, and we were literally brainwashed to be environmentalists and to live in coexistence with planet Earth. And this message was speaking to me, and I took it very seriously. I think one of the typicalities of the sustainability discussion is that the temporality is often concentrating on present day issues and future challenges. And what I don't really see is the historical perspective. And quite often when fellow scientists, social scientists discuss challenges of sustainability, they might disregard very important lessons, information that we could be retrieved from past stories. One of the examples is circularity and circular economy. And one of history's lessons is that circular economies have existed in the past. In fact, most economies used to be circle before the 19th century. The open systems that we have created in the past 100 years, this is a new thing. This is very new to us. I would like to see a perspective of history coming into the sustainability discussion and putting these current issues, current questions into a historical perspective. That, okay, we have these issues now, and some of them are completely new, but some of them are not that new. Some of them we have been struggling since, you know, beginning of time, since Adam and Eve. So why don't we use those lessons? Why don't we use those information that archaeologists, historians, and other scientists can convey us? When we are talking about climate change, there is, especially in Finland, what I see that there is so much talk about quick fixes and technology, and technological decisions will come and save us. This is a sort of techno-optimism that I see in many of the communist bureau documents, that, oh, we'll adopt this new technology and it will just miraculously save us. We always forget, we humans, that whatever we do, there's going to be a reprisal, there's going to be an effect. Whatever we do, there's going to be side effects. Whatever we think, whatever we think about, we cannot map out all the consequences. When you look into history, it makes you more humble about the sway of humankind and the kind of decision that we can and we should take and make. And I think history is also teaching us something that we don't understand and we don't accept, and neither of the political parties accept this. Not in Finland, not in the European Union, major political parties, that we should think and consider going poor again. This is the best environmentalist strategy for everyone you can ever imagine. Thinking about, not calculating stuff, not about how to make the system very complicated and technocratic, but just shrinking, making it smaller. But whenever you look into history, the kind of lifestyle that we have in Finland, or in fact in most of Europe, it's absolutely unique in a historical context, and it's abnormal from a historical perspective.